Over 12 years ago, Andy Bramante left his career as a well-compensated corporate chemist to teach research science at Greenwich High School. His class has no exams, no curriculum, tests, lectures, or textbooks. The 48 kids accepted into Andy's class each year are self-driven, share a passion to innovate, and to compete in the brutally competitive science fair circuit. And they do amazingly well, winning top prizes and securing large monetary awards from the likes of Google and Intel, and even getting invited to the Nobel Prize ceremonies in Stockholm. Student projects include inventing inexpensive diagnostic tests for artery blockage and Alzheimer's, achieving industry-rewarded systems for carbon capture, developing potential cures for Lyme disease, developing a liquid smart or therapeutic bandage, and even creating a fast test for Ebola. Our guide through a remarkable year, 2017, with this remarkable group of students and their sensei, Andy Bramante, is Heather Won Tesoriero, whose new book, The Class, A Life-Changing Teacher, His World-Changing Kids, and the Most Inventive Classroom in America, is an immersion in the world of intellectually curious adolescents, challenged by the usual high school adventures like relationships, activity overload, family matters, and peer pressures. They're shepherded along in their research project development by Andy, who often finds himself in the position of family counselor, social worker, networker, and stressed-out teacher-parent himself. Heather is a former Emmy Award-winning CBS News producer and former reporter for The Wall Street Journal, Time, and Newsweek. She left CBS to totally immerse herself in the world of Andy Bramante and his Greenwich High savants. The Class is a thrilling ride through the excitement of successful research, the heartbreak of failures, the torture of college admissions, where a Harvard admission is not guaranteed to even a class valedictorian and Intel Science Fair winner. Heather is my guest today. Stay with us for an exciting conversation. But first, let's watch the trailer for The Class. I'm Alice Bloom. This is A Town and Village 2.
For more than 20 years, I was a scientist in industry. Started my industrial career at a place called Foxborough, and then spent a couple years there, worked for Hitachi, where I got to travel a lot. I get to see the world. The fact is, I work many more hours now than I ever have before.
When I met Andy Bramante, I knew immediately that I wanted to write a book about who he is and what he does. I'm Heather Won Tesoriero, author of The Class.
You know, people often ask me, would you go back? Do you hate what you did? I like this more, but you give me great science with a bunch of stale kids, and it's probably not nearly the same experience.
When I stepped into Andy's lab at Greenwich High School and saw what his class was doing, I was riveted. Here was a guy who walked away from a great career in science to teach high school kids. He had no idea what was going to happen, and what's happened is astonishing. I spent the entire 2016 school year with Andy's science research class, chronicling the projects and lives of him and his kids.
I developed a machine learning algorithm that could detect pre-malignant pancreatic cancer from patient blood.
I developed a polymer nanocomposite with embedded boron nitride nanotubes.
I'm creating a liquid band-aid with an antibacterial component to it.
I've had Lyme disease for 3 years. So my project is an alternative medicine that Lyme disease patients would be taking.
You think that only adults can make these discoveries, and then you get in the middle of these kids with incredible imagination to see these discoveries that they make. I mean, it's what gets you up in the morning.
So what's driving these kids? They're aiming to compete on the global science fair circuit. These competitions are fierce and the stakes are high. Sometimes they're vying for hundreds of thousands of dollars and hoping a big win will ease their entry to top colleges. So why this class, this teacher, and these kids?
I don't think this class could really be replicated anywhere else because secret ingredient is Mr. Bramante.
He's very passionate, he's very dedicated.
Mr. B's class has really been life-changing.
There are so many things that make the class unique, all of which are captured in the book. The competitive fire of the students, the sophistication of the science, and the inner lives of these kids who, after all, are still just teenagers. And at the heart of it all is this otherworldly teacher. When I set foot in the class, I had no idea just how surprising and thrilling it would be.
Welcome, Heather. Thanks so much for being my guest. Well, this is not the stuff of ant farms and vinegar volcanoes. This is really high-level research. How did Andy make the transition from corporate chemistry, being a corporate scientist, to working with high school kids?
Andy had actually been teaching at the college level at night as an adjunct over the course of his corporate career, and it was something that he maintained, even though his full-time job was working in industry. And as many people do, you know, he started to get sort of fed up with corporate life. And so it had kind of been in the back of his mind that maybe he wanted to give high school teaching a try. And so when really he was ready to pull up his stakes in corporate life, he turned to the idea of teaching in high school.
Okay. Now, did this program exist before he got there?
It did, actually. There was an independent science research program at Greenwich High. He had a predecessor, a very talented teacher as well, named Ray Hamilton. And Ray, you know, had a very robust program too. And I interviewed Ray for the book, and he said, you know, what Andy did was he took a great program and he made it even better.
How nice.
Yeah.
Now, how do kids apply for this? What are the qualifications for admission to the program?
Well, one of the things that I found really fascinating is that you would think, as you say, that these are very high-level projects, that Andy would be seeking a type of student. And what was very interesting to me is that he doesn't seek a type. He asks kids to write a proposal of an idea or a scientific project that they might want to work on. They do not have to have the answers. They just have to have the enthusiasm and an idea. And he reads their proposals carefully, but he's not really looking for scientific genius. He's looking for kids who are motivated, kids who he thinks have the sort of emotional and the temperamental stamina to stay with a project over the course of a year, because it's science. So there are many ups and downs, and there's success and failure. So he's looking for somebody who can really sort of hang in there with the project. He does not look for the straight-A student.
Okay. Well, do students apply in their junior year?
They can apply at any time
during high school?
Yes.
And their commitment is for only 1 year or for a longer term?
They typically do, if they start the class as a sophomore, they typically will stay for 3 years. Same if they start in their junior year, they'll stay for two. He does get the occasional freshman, kids who have known about the program, and they apply in eighth grade to start their freshman year. He has a really good track record in terms of retention. Kids become really, I mean, they love this class, so they come back again and again.
Well, it sounds like it's more of I don't want to diminish it by saying a club, but it's a real connection.
Yes.
I mean, a haven in probably a very competitive environment.
It is. And I also noticed an interesting dynamic with the kids and with Andy, which is that, yes, they're there to do their projects. They work really hard on their projects. But to your point, it is a haven. It becomes a place where they're able to sort of unwind a bit and sort of take a breather from what otherwise is an incredibly demanding high school academic life. And you might ask, well, why does this class become that haven? I mean, part of it is because of the loose stricture that they're, you know, they don't have the test. This is not driven by grades, and this is not driven by tests and quizzes and papers and things like that. And another big part of that is Andy himself. I mean, he really creates an atmosphere where the kids can be themselves and they can relax. And you could just see them, like, rush into the room and kind of decompress.
Has he ever had to ask a student to leave?
He has had to ask students not to return. I don't think he's ever sort of asked someone to leave in the course of the year, but there are kids who take the sort of haven aspect to it, the sort of relax and let your hair down aspect to it, a little too far. And he's had to say, you know what, I don't think that this is working out, and you know, I don't think it's in anyone's best interest for you to come back next year.
Okay, so but that sounds like it's rare.
Very rare, yes.
Rare occasion. How focused is Andy and the kids, or are they all focused on science fairs and the awards?
There's a real mix. There's definitely a population of kids who come into the class with the clear goal that they want to make it to the fairs and they want to win at those fairs. And they're kind of really deeply motivated by that. But there are other kids who really just take a great deal of pleasure in the science. And doing a science project is not sort of an add water mix and you can do it. It takes a lot of thought, a lot of planning, a lot of trial and error. So there are some kids who just really get immersed in the process and they're sort of like, you know, I may make it to the fair, I may not make it to the fair, but I just have to really focus on the work.
And they're happy with that. Is there pressure from the school or the community to win?
There's a lot of pressure from the parents. Yes, the parents sometimes become, I would say, over-motivated in their desire for their kids to win at these science fairs. And what's driving that, my impression after spending a year with Andy's class, is that that is driven by the idea that a win at a science fair is going to gild the road to college acceptance.
And is that the case?
It can. It can. I mean, there are certain competitions that are so prestigious that it certainly adds a bit of fairy dust to your application. And I think that parents have picked up on that. And so they sort of, they're motivated less by the process and whether their kids are necessarily learning or enjoying it, but they're motivated by the outcome.
Now, how does Andy handle those very difficult parents?
It is not easy. There are some parents that really require, to use your words, handling. They require a little bit of perspective. Sometimes they'll blow off steam if their child doesn't advance in the way that they were hoping for. And Andy has to really kind of sort of gently and kindly, but also frankly, bring it back home for them and say, look, this really isn't about the fairs. This is really about learning and science and enjoying it. And the fair component is part of it, but that can't be the whole thing. And so, you know, if you could just take a step back. And there are several times a year, I would say, when those conversations have to happen.
I just wonder how effective that is, because parents who are very highly motivated tend to not hear what they don't want to hear.
It's true. And there have been times when he's had those conversations and they're totally ineffective because there is that sort of blind drive for the win.
Let's talk a little bit, before we get to talking about the fairs themselves and what it's like to apply and be part of it, which I thought was extremely dramatic. I had no idea. I mean, I remember the Westinghouse Science Fair and school science fairs and posters and people asked you about your project, but nothing at this level. We'll talk about that in a minute, but let's talk a little bit about Greenwich itself.
Yes.
We have the, perhaps it's, you know, concept or mythology that Greenwich is all laptops and lattes and that everybody's extremely well endowed financially and well motivated. You paint a different picture of Greenwich. Certainly that level of affluence exists, but there's more to it.
Yes, and I have to say, when I originally went to Greenwich to do, the genesis of the book is that I was producing a story for CBS where I was a producer about one of Andy's kids who won the Google Science Fair. So I was working at CBS at that time. I had no intention of writing a book. And when I went to Greenwich that day, I went with all of those assumptions that this is a very affluent community, it's very privileged, sort of snooty. And I really thought that it was going to be filled with this sort of predictable set of stock characters. When I got there to report the book, my perception was completely changed because what I found is there's actually a thriving and significant, in terms of numbers, population of immigrants. Immigrants, and not only from, they don't all come from one part of the world. There are immigrants from Central and South America. There's a huge Asian immigrant population. There are many Europeans. There are people who come for all different reasons. Some are transferred for corporate work. Some come, you know, the good old-fashioned American dream, and they're, you know, working the kinds of support jobs in an affluent community, gardeners, nannies, cooks, things like that, and entrepreneurs. I mean, so it really spanned the spectrum. It is certainly not just sort of financial hedge fund sort of funded families. It's very diverse, both racially, socioeconomically. But the thing that joins everybody together in this community is the public school system. Greenwich is a very high-performing public school system. Pardon me. And so all of these families from all these disparate, you know, areas of life are really drawn to the town, the school district. And many families that do not come from extreme wealth, they make a lot of sacrifices to live in Greenwich because it's not easily affordable.
Truly, the houses are expensive and there's taxes and all of that. But there are also subtle differences. How do the very affluent mingle with those who are struggling?
The public school is the main sort of meeting place, if you will, where a lot of those worlds start intersecting and overlapping. Because to be honest with you, were it not for the public school district, a lot of those communities wouldn't necessarily come into contact with each other. And interestingly, in Andy's class, his class really represents that mix that we've been talking about. And so it's there that those parents start actually being in conversation with each other.
Now, so to my surprise, you paint the program as not particularly well funded by the Greenwich School District. I think you said they allot $1,200 per student per project.
$1,200 for the entire class.
Oh, I misunderstood
yes.
that. That's shocking.
Yes.
I mean, that doesn't pay for test tubes and microscopes
or any of
the tools. Where does the rest of the money come? I mean, you say most of these projects cost many thousands of dollars.
They can. An individual project, not all of them, but in some cases, an individual project can cost thousands of dollars. So the Greenwich District, during the time that I was there and for the 12 years preceding, they allotted between $1,000 and $1,200 for the entire class for the year.
I'm just shocked. So does Andy have to do fundraising?
Yes. So he basically came up with a system, if you could call it that, where he was sort of forced to hold his tin cup out and ask parents in the community and also just community patrons who didn't even have kids in the class if they would be willing to support the program. But what he did was, and this is really important, he would always make it very clear, if you donate, if you make a contribution, this money is not earmarked for your child. Because what that would do is it would disproportionately favor kids whose parents could afford to fund their projects. So that's really, you know, not fair. So he said, if you contribute money, it goes into the larger fund and you're supporting the class as a whole. And the money gets used as needed. It's not for an individual child or an individual project.
And how does that work?
You know, I have to say, it's a boom or bust cycle because some years families, for whatever reason, were incredibly generous or able or in a good position to be able to support the class. And in some years, it was very little money coming in. The other revenue stream for his class, in many of the competitions, as kids win, a little bit of money goes to the class itself. So that's how he would build up his coffers every year. So it was kind of a cycle. You know, the more kids that would win, the more money that would come in to support the next year's class.
Now let's talk about those science fairs. So kids who do win often get some money, but it has to be earmarked for their college funds.
That's correct.
Whether or not they need the money
right.
for the college fund.
That's right.
And then the school gets a little bit of money
mm-hmm.
to fund further research. Tell us about the preparation for these fairs. What's it like?
Well, for Andy's kids, they sort of, they will have applied in the previous spring if they're accepted into the class. For the most part, most of them know in the fall, like, okay, this is what I'm going to work on. And the science fair, the preparations really start ramping up around Thanksgiving because the fairs, to go to the big national or international fairs, you usually have to win at the local level. In Greenwich's case, that means at the Connecticut State Fair. So that fair is in March, and then there's another fair that can get you to the bigger circuit, if you will, in February. So if you can imagine November, December, January, very intense time.
I know how different things are in preparation for legal matters, the kinds of sophistication in posters. It's no longer oak tag and markers. I mean, things are done professionally. How do the students access the kind of resources to make their projects look professional?
Well, it's very interesting you say that because Andy uses he and his kids use a sort of format that, you know, some people say that's like the iconic Greenwich poster. It's mounted on foam core. It is professionally printed. You know, it's not some, the kids are not, you know, super gluing it at home.
No. These are not unsophisticated presentations.
Yes.
But how do they access those resources? Does the school have a facility for production of?
No, Andy, he creates a series of deadlines and then he actually gets them professionally printed at a printing house outside.
So he assists the students in doing that. Because I just didn't understand how students could possibly have the kind of connections and resources to do that.
And then he kind of wants to manage that part because he wants there to be equity across all students. In other words, he doesn't want some kid's poster to look like, wow, that looks really professional, and then the other kid's is like, you know, hand-markered or whatever. So he creates a series of deadlines, and as long as you kind of get all of your stuff to him, he will oversee and make sure that they get professionally published.
Are the students
printed.
Very competitive amongst themselves in the class?
Yes. Some years, it differs from year to year, and it depends on the temperaments of the kids. And there have been years where the competition was fierce and sort of turned the corner to ugly, and then there have been years where it's much more of a supportive atmosphere. But I'm not going to lie, there's always an undercurrent of competition because at the end of the day, the goal for many of these kids is to get to these fairs. And then there was a moment I had when I was reporting the book. I went to the first big fair of the year, and because Andy's kids' projects really stood out in the class of projects that were at the fair, I had this sort of sinking feeling in my stomach because I realized, I said, you know, they're really all competing against each other. That's really what's happening at this fair. And I thought, I don't know if this is all dawning on them at the same time that it's dawning on me.
And how did that work out?
That year, his kids, they cleaned up. They won the top three spots that they were seeking to win.
Pretty remarkable.
Yes.
Is there a downside to winning?
I think that the downside comes if the kids and the parents, if they can't take pleasure in the win itself, if they only see it as a means to an end, if they only see it as something to put on their resume for college, then it just kind of gets tossed into the pile of things that you pray and hope and dream are going to get you into the college of your choice. But if you really can savor the victory for what it is, I think that a lot of kids get really happy and they feel really triumphant. But like I said, if it turns into this, you know, is this going to get me into Yale or Harvard or Princeton? If that's the only thing that it's really connected to in their minds, then I think that is a real downside.
Are the judges at these fairs able to smoke out the real, I don't want to use the word competitive, the real dedicated, devoted scientists amongst the students and separate them from those who are just using it as a vehicle for admission to college?
I think that they can to some degree. I think if you take a step back, I think their job a lot of times is trying to figure out how much involvement and how much work of this project was really driven and executed by the student, and was there outside involvement?
Because from the questioning and reading the book is a trip through the science fairs, and you feel the tension, I mean, feel the knot in my stomach as the judges really grill the students, and it's not a softball kind of, oh, it looks beautiful, honey.
Right.
I mean, it's not like that at all.
No.
But you also talk about social media and the kind of assaults there are for some of the students who succeed quite well in the fairs, and then they are pulled down to the detriment of their emotional psyche.
Yes,
or something.
And that was something that was really surprising. I think that sometimes, historically, people have had the idea of the kind of kid or the kind of student who participates in the science fair, that it's going to be this nerdy, geeky kid. And then with that, you might think, well, those kinds of kids don't really get involved in the kind of cyber bullying and cyber sniping and trying to, like, you know, bring other people down. And everything about what I just said turned out not to be true. So first of all, there really isn't a type of kid who does the science fair circuit. There isn't this sort of geeky, nerdy, one-dimensional person that shows up and that's it. And with that, that means that there are kids who unfortunately are willing to go to any number of lengths to kind of take pot shots at the competition.
You know, to your point, what impressed me the most with, very well with many of the kids is how well-rounded they are. Many of them are athletes and musicians and, you know, do lots of other things. A lot of them are very involved with their families. They're not just, as you say, geeky science kids. And yet there are some who are, what do we used to call them, geniuses with no minds, someone who couldn't order a bagel, but
right.
but has this fabulous idea.
Yes, that's right.
For innovation. Let's talk about some of the projects. What
sure.
impressed you the most?
Well, I would be remiss if I didn't mention Ethan Novak. Ethan joined the class. Ethan is an outlier. I will just have to say that right out of the gate. Ethan winds up leaving Greenwich High in his junior year to pursue his scientific work in the area of carbon capture. He starts working at Yale in a lab, and then eventually his project it gains so much traction and so much momentum. He obtains utility patents for it, and he starts working.
He's 17 years old
yes.
or so, and he has a utility patent.
Yes,
okay.
He had several, and then he decides, along with the support of his family, both emotional and financial, to go pursue the construction of his work at a research lab in Texas with an eye toward developing it for commercial use. And I just need to say Ethan is an outlier. He he's somebody, and I do talk about this in the book, that you would think by what I just said that this is going to be like some ultra nerdy, geeky kid. And he is Mr. Social Skills, Mr. Personality Plus. He walks in a room. He is the most self-possessed, charming, mature young man. And so everything about him, you think, this is unnatural. This is strange. Why would any young teenager be doing this with their time? And then you meet him, and it's sort of like you would meet him and think, God, that kid should be running a company. Well, he is. He founded his own company. Yeah.
And he must have gotten funding from other commercial enterprises.
His project has continued to build momentum, and he is, you know, in talks for partnerships all the time.
Pretty remarkable. Heather, are there any other programs like this in the country that you found?
Yes. So in order to get to the Science Fair Circuit, like I said, to the big leagues of the Science Fair Circuit, most of the time you have to win at a regional or local level. So that means that there are science fairs, you know, all over the country, all over the world, and therefore there are programs that support them. But there's a major difference between the way Andy Bramante's classes run and other science fair classes or science in research classes. And that's that many classes have a format where there's a teacher who then farms the students out to professional labs or university labs, and they work with an on-site mentor at that institution or at that company. And they do the work off-site. And then the teacher back at school is sort of like a high-level project manager, making sure that they're doing their work on time, keeping the trains running, checking in, and just making sure that their work is going to get them to a place where they can go to the fair. Because Andy was a corporate scientist himself, what he has done is he's built out the lab at Greenwich High with tons and tons of professional-grade equipment in such a way that the kids actually do all their work on site at Greenwich High.
Pretty remarkable. Heather, I wish we had more time, but unfortunately we don't. I wish you great success with the class.
Thank you.
It is well worth reading. I enjoyed it so much, and I look forward to your next project.
Thank you so much, Alice.
Thanks for being my guest. And thanks at home for watching. We'll see you next time.